Welcome back to the Catherine Thomas Podcast. Time and presence are the greatest gifts that we can give. Thank you for sharing those with me today. My goals for our time spent together today are threefold: reframing, recharging, and reemerging. Reframing, referring to observing life through a different lens and finding the extraordinary in the ordinary. Recharging, referring to resetting mind and heart to a place of calmness, compassion, and curiosity. Reemerging, referring to leaving today's conversation inspired to make a difference in the world through small and simple actions. In about 30 minutes, you can get the oil changed in your car, have a pizza delivered, or watch a show on Netflix. What if we use that same allotment of time to give our mindset a needed adjustment? I intentionally created this episode to be shorter than usual. Often, when we are in the greatest need of taking a pause to reboot, life gets busier. We need to focus on refilling our pitchers in the shortest time possible, passing over what is frivolous to restore ease and contentment. Today, we're going to mix things up a bit. I'm going to share inspiration I've received during periods of stillness, as well as aspirational thoughts from my three favorite podcasters, Ed Milette, Mel Robbins, and Rachel Hollis. Ready to take pause from life's busyness to readjust your outlook? Let's dive in. My stillness tune-up. As I was transitioning from simply existing to living authentically, I was inspired by a quote from Alan Watts. You are under no obligation to be the same person you were 5 minutes ago. I loved that perspective, framing every moment as a fresh start in living my one wild and precious life. In my previous life, I held tight to the perceived security of consistency. Consistency can be a wonderful thing in many situations, allowing for predictability. Life, however, is consistent in the fact that it is always changing. We are constantly gaining new information and experiences. Even within the course of a single day, we end it with more information and experiences than we started with. Our minds find comfort in the familiar and consistent, but our evolving souls call out for transformation to rise to new truths. We can choose to change ourselves to match our new awareness or stay the same despite enhanced understanding. Some areas of life call for and benefit from consistency. Self-care routines, caring for dependents, providing for our financial well-being, and following laws and rules created to keep ourselves and others safe. Other areas evolve as we do. Political views, friendships, spiritual philosophies, occupations, and life purpose. Recently, in a blissful state of quietude, I was deeply affected by the theory that we are best equipped to serve the person we were 5 years ago. When I pondered what I would tell my past self or another person going through a similar life transition, I had the following thoughts. Number one, be less concerned with the perception that other people are judging you. Not only are they focused on themselves, but any opinions they may have of you are none of your business. Number two, focus on the true purpose of your physical body, being the earthly vehicle of your soul. Take wonderful care of it, but prioritize mental, emotional, and spiritual growth over vanity. Number three, trust yourself to have autonomy over your life. When observing doubt, remember past events that seemed insurmountable at the time, but were overcome. Know that you can assemble a team of life helpers to assist, but make sure you're the one with the final say. Don't let fear keep you out of the driver's seat. Number four, taking time and energy to consciously evolve into your authentic self is not selfish. You are serving those around you by deriving validation from your own life rather than piggybacking off theirs. Some people in your life may not resonate with the new you, and that is okay. The goal is to be completely at peace with being with yourself. Your new vibe will attract the appropriate tribe. Podcasts as inspiration for making change. A couple of years back, I sought out a solution to enable my post-work mind to transition from highway speed to the deceleration ramp. I needed to reset my mindset to a quieter and more contemplative place before embarking on my evening routine. That goal was achieved by listening to podcasts. Please note that I said listening. Although my podcasts can be viewed on YouTube, I opt to simply listen. I sit in my favorite chair, off of my phone, and look out my patio door. After a screen-centric day, utilizing my auditory system and imagination helped me power down. With distractions eliminated, I can focus on my breathing and put my spotlight on the message the speaker is conveying rather than being distracted by images and mindless phone scrolling. Instead of mindless consumption of news and social media, I wanted to be in control of what I was being exposed to. I chose inspiration instead of overwhelm and entertainment. I focused on content that would increase ease and understanding versus FOMO and comparison. I sought out inspirational viewpoints that would allow me to learn more about the world so I could show greater compassion for myself and others. A popular theory states that we are a compilation of the five people we spend the most time with. I am grateful to have added this dynamic group of podcasters to my sphere of influence. My hope is that by sharing the wisdom I gained from them, not only will you be inspired, but also find new podcasters to add to your queue. Ed Milet. When I'm looking to be inspired by a no excuses, tell it like it is approach, I turn to the Ed Milet Show. Ed is an author, podcaster, business leader, and coach to leading executives, athletes, and entertainers. His platform is taking responsibility for the cultivation of personal advancement by embracing a growth-focused mindset. He advocates continuous learning, seeking mentors, and investing in self-improvement as the means of meeting that objective. He holds the belief that abilities and intelligence can be developed through effort and practice. Becoming a stronger and better version of ourselves is simply a matter of getting over the fear of failure to grow, realizing that growth and change are not only okay, but necessary. Ed is passionate about people moving through life with purpose. To do that, we must identify and define our values, strengths, and interests. He believes we were all put here with gifts to share. Our purpose is to serve. His aspirational philosophies focus on the following: the power of one more, thermostat management, emotional home ownership, reframing failure and rejection, and harnessing the superpowers of inner frequency and mental and emotional fitness. The power of one more. In his book, The Power of One More, Ed states that the struggle with self-confidence is universal. Lacking self-confidence makes us unable to keep promises to ourselves. Mastering self-confidence involves keeping the promises we make to ourselves. By upholding smaller promises, it sets the stage for keeping the bigger ones. His one more mindset involves moving past one's comfort zone and giving extra effort in all aspects of life. By dissolving self-imposed limitations, it is possible to strive for excellence in all undertakings. This perspective allows for challenging self-imposed barriers, overcoming challenges, and creating permanent change. Ed notes that even if we do not always reach our goals utilizing this approach, we always achieve our standards in the long term. Ed proclaims that our lives can be lived to the fullest by taking just one more positive action. Incremental progress is key, as the power of small actions serve to bring about significant results. He supports the power of the compound effect, with consistent and incremental actions resulting in long-term results. When we bring about the changes needed in our most important relationship, the one we have with ourselves, we approach life from a place of trust and security. Desired results are achieved not by being smarter than everyone else, but by outworking them. He illustrates this in terms of separation seasons. For athletes, he refers to this as the off-season. In general life, he refers to this as holiday seasons. It's during these times where, if we motivate ourselves to make consistent and incremental change, we can rise above our competition. Ed eloquently sums up his One More philosophy as follows. Greatness is within reach when individuals consistently strive for improvement, embrace discomfort, and make the commitment to take one more step towards their goals. Thermostat management. Ed uses the analogy of a thermostat to address the biggest obstacle in achieving meaningful change, issues with identity. He describes our identity and the beliefs we have about ourselves as our thermostat. He says we have an internal thermostat setting for achievement. Low thermostat levels are a byproduct of narratives in which we reinforce to ourselves that we are unworthy of success. To maintain an appropriate setting or raise the temperature of success in our lives, we must be intentional of the company we are keeping. Ed asserts that maintaining our optimal thermostat level is directly correlated with the associations we maintain. Higher degree people inspire us to raise ours to their level. Exposure to lower degree individuals reduces us to theirs. Although we may achieve high goals with a lower setting, until we address the primary issue of increasing our overall setting, we will always default to the lower level. Ed sums up his philosophy as follows. Surround yourself with people who see you as better than you are and hold that standard. They have an expectation that you can do and be better and have a future-focused mentality, always thinking about how to grow and evolve. Emotional home ownership. Ed holds the belief that to achieve change, we need to take ownership of our emotional homes. He defines emotional home as the set of emotions we default to at any given moment, regardless of what is transpiring around us. We gravitate them because the familiar is the path of least resistance. They might be anger, joy, anxiety, bliss, or envy. Our emotional mindset can only be transformed when we are intentional about our emotions, as they are completely within our power. He believes the foundation of our emotional home was constructed in childhood. Without conscious awareness, we consistently default to that set of emotions even when the external world isn't dictating it. While most people can easily verbalize what they desire, it's a matter of addressing the thoughts related to that goal. By intentionally laying our internal building blocks to bring about external contentment, we can then experience solid footing in life. He states, human beings are really good at getting what they want once they are intentional about it. Reframing failure and rejection. Ed believes that mindset is key to experiencing personal evolution and transformation. He defines four crucial things for obtaining an evolved mindset: faith, intention, action, and the 99% theory. Regardless of what one's faith is, he believes it's crucial to embrace the fact we are not alone and have trust in a higher power to serve our best interests. He emphasizes the importance of connecting one's beliefs to their intentions rather than their abilities. Intentionality is imperative for deciding what to create in life, serving as the map. Ed states that the biggest killer of dreams is delay. Delay is rooted in fear of failure. Failing, however, means that progress is being made. Excellence can only be achieved through action. In his 99% theory, Ed expounds that 99% of people have an operating system in their brain that is history and memory, a state in which they operate out of all of the time. The remaining 1% rise above that, choosing instead to operate out of a place of creativity and inspiration, achieving the life of their dreams. Harnessing the superpowers of inner frequency and mental and emotional fitness. Ed holds the belief that we are energetic beings. That energy serves to attract and repel people and things into our lives. Living on autopilot, numbed by busyness and distraction, disconnects us from our inner frequency. By achieving a state of mental stillness through meditation, solitude, or taking a break from technology, we position ourselves to become reconnected to what best serves us. Ed stresses the importance of developing mental and emotional fitness, saying that those who achieve greatness do so through small actions done daily. Consistent effort builds momentum, develops habits of excellence, and brings about lasting change. It creates a confident mindset, the ability to reframe challenges as opportunities for growth, and an attitude of perseverance, allowing the confidence and drive to stay committed to standards and goals, even in difficult seasons. Mel Robbins. Mel begins every episode with, "It's your friend Mel." Like a good friend, she brings needed honesty with plenty of humor and sauciness for added flavor. Three concepts introduced on her podcast resonated with me. The 51% rule, let them, and the 5-second rule. The 51% rule. Mel hosted entrepreneur Steve Bartlett on the episode entitled The 51% Rule and Three More Strategies to Think Like a Millionaire. Their thought-provoking discussion highlighted the importance of questioning assumptions of failure and success and engaging in self-reflection as the means of moving towards happiness and fulfillment. The 51% rule advocates acting on a decision when a level of 51% certainty has been achieved, rather than waiting for an elusive 100%. Instead of floundering and overthinking and self-doubt, you elect to act when your certainty level is just over 50%. Jeff Bezos is also a supporter of this mindset. He subscribes to a bias for action to reduce stress and increase productivity. He believes you can make good decisions without having all the information if you're willing to communicate what you know, listen to others, and iterate. His theory is backed by research indicating that leading with a bias for action allows for a more decisive and courageous company climate. Both Bezos and Mel Robbins agree that the 51% rule and similar bias for action are made more palatable by placing decisions into reversible and irreversible categories. Recognizing that many decisions are reversible provides greater ease and comfort with committing to a decision, as they can be easily remedied if they prove to be unsuccessful. Reversible decisions can be rapidly executed, saving more time for irreversible decisions that require more caution due to their long-lasting consequences. Mental energy is then appropriately allocated, resulting in greater forward momentum. Bartlett and Robbins address the harm of stagnation. When a decision is a reversible one, one loses out by not taking advantage of the ability for experimentation. Swift decision-making is not only crucial for personal growth and fulfillment, but also for the avoidance of regret. The biggest risk often lies in the failure to act. Let them. Mel's let them theory is one of the most impactful pieces of advice I have received from any podcast. She believes we expend way too much time and energy attempting to force others to align with our expectations. Her take on radical acceptance involves understanding where our influence ends and accepting what is beyond our power to control. When we release concerns about managing the behavior and actions of others, we experience more calmness and ease in our lives. Deciding to simply let them do what it is they intend to do brings more emotional peace and fulfillment to our friendships and romantic relationships. Embracing the let them philosophy in relationships means loving your partner as they are, focusing instead on how you respond and interact rather than trying to mold or control them. The let them philosophy promotes a stance of non-judgmental acceptance, especially in situations we cannot fully control, which is most situations. This allows us to move through life with more ease. She sums up let them in the following manner. Let them be themselves because they are revealing who they are to you. Just let them. Then you get to choose what you do next. The 5-second rule. The biggest obstacle in initiating positive change is getting started. Mel addresses this issue with her 5-second rule. This philosophy is aimed at those who overthink or shut down when faced with indecision or anxiety about performing. The 5-second rule serves as a tool to overcome resistance and complete tasks, especially non-habitual tasks that previously felt impossible due to anxiety, depression, or lack of motivation. According to Mel, it takes just 5 seconds for the brain to convince us not to do something if it isn't already part of our routine. When we have the impulse to do something that isn't part of our routine, the brain generates reasons why that new action may lead to negative consequences. If we do not jump into action within 5 seconds, our brain will shut it down. The brain triggers this overthinking to protect us from possible unknown negative consequences of non-habitual action. By simply counting down from 5 to 1 over the course of 5 seconds and acting immediately upon reaching 1, agency is asserted and fear and self-doubt are kept at bay. Robin states, counting backwards requires focus, and when you focus, your prefrontal cortex awakens, and by the way, that's the part of the brain that helps you learn new positive behavior patterns. Here's a top 5 list of benefits from embracing the 5-second rule. Number 1, action replaces rumination and self-doubt. 2, a greater sense of emotional control is achieved. Number 3, it encourages boldness versus being passive. Number 4, self-confidence and courage increase. Number 5, it allows for opportunities inaction would have prevented. Rachel Hollis. Rachel is a dynamic woman who unabashedly shares her transformative journey and fiercely holds others accountable for theirs. A single question and simple directive on her podcast inspired me. The $1 million question. I found the following query to be incredibly impactful. Are you afraid of failure, or are you afraid of them watching you fail? Rachel states that we don't suffer from a fear problem, but rather one of ego. She strongly reminds us that wanting better or something new involves taking a new course of action, and failure is the price of admission. When we embark on something new, we are a beginner. Comparing our beginning to someone else's middle or end kills our motivation to continue on the path of growth. She drives home the importance of giving ourselves compassion during the process and taking responsibility for getting over our egos. Only with this mindset can we muddle through the beginning stages to achieve mastery and growth. Embrace the suck. In an especially powerful episode, Rachel shared with her listeners that she has a tattoo stating, "Embrace the suck." This permanent reminder holds her accountable for remembering that strength comes from addressing and conquering challenges, not avoiding them. On the path to improvement, everyone starts at the beginning, and that's the first step in the journey. Rachel succinctly sums up this philosophy with the following thought. Mastery is paved with persistence, resilience, and the willingness to embrace a heck of a lot of sucking. today, we explored how choosing to take a 30-minute pause, identical in duration to the ones we already commit to for our vehicles, ordering dinner, and chilling with Netflix, can enhance our outlook on life. I'm all about being vulnerable, so I have a confession to make. The creation of this episode was extremely challenging for me. For the first time, I encountered writer's block and self-doubt. I sat with my resistance and came up with a mantra to push through: progress, not perfection. I found myself calling on the wisdom of the 5-second rule, the power of one more, and embracing the suck to create my best and most authentic work. Before sitting down at my computer, I stated out loud what my intentions were for my work session, counted backwards from 5, and set into action upon reaching 1. When I achieved my goal, I pushed past it, accomplishing just a little bit more. This empowered me to see that I could exceed what I thought was possible, resulting in steadfast determination to do it again the next day. I quieted my inner critic by reminding myself that I am new to podcasting and need to approach this endeavor humbly and with a beginner's mind. Instead of being deterred by inevitable potholes in the road ahead, confidently circumventing them and continuing the journey. For me, creating this episode exceeded its intended purpose of being a mindset tune-up. It was also a gentle reminder to top off my self-compassion tank. My wish is that it will do the same for you. Thank you so much for taking the time to tune in today. If you found today's episode helpful, I would love it if you'd share it with someone else who might also enjoy it. My book of poetry and photography, Awakening the Vulnerable Heart, is available on Amazon. Until we meet again, may you find beauty.